Guitar tips, just the tips, just for you. Guitar tips. Hello and welcome to another episode of Guitar Tips. My name is Adam Levy and this is my video blog series right here on YouTube. For the past several weeks, I've been doing an alphabetical mini-series called The ABCs of Guitar Tips. And I could tell you more about it, but I've already talked about it here. If you want to know what inspired this ABCs trip that I'm on, and if you want to know where I've been so far, go back to the beginning. There's a playlist here called The ABCs of Guitar Tips. You can check out the playlist, start at the beginning, work your way forward, or just jump around, whatever you are into. This episode here is on something that begins with M, and of course I'm going to talk about the metronome, using a metronome in your practice routine. And there's really five important points that I want to get to about using the metronome. So number one is I really recommend that you turn your metronome on before you start practicing. It can be a little unnerving if you sit down to practice and you're working on something that's a little challenging, and all of a sudden you've got this tick, tick, tick going, and it's like, you know, it can spook you and make you not want to practice or get discouraged or whatever. So what I usually do is turn the metronome on before practice time and just let it run for a little while, and you get a little bit used to it. It stops being such a I don't know, there's this Edgar Allan Poe story about this beating heart that this guy can't stop hearing. The metronome shouldn't be like that. It should really be something that's a good sound to you, a friendly sound, a sound that means, hey, it's time to practice. And it's, you know, it's going to help you. So the reason that I turn it on before I sit down is, one is to a little bit just take the edge off and get used to this thing that's going to be ticking away. I'll turn it off now just so I can talk a little bit. And then the other reason is that I find it helps me to get the sense of that, whatever the tempo is. This is 92, you know, that's just where it is right now. Get it in my body before I try to make my hands move around at that tempo. So, you know, as the metronome's on, I might, you know, walk across the house to, you know, get a glass of water or something, or I might do anything and just notice that the rhythm is there and see if I can feel the rhythm in my body before I start practicing scales or any kind of mechanical thing. I really want to feel the tempo in the rest of my body and then get my hands to be in sync with it. So does that, I hope that makes sense. But that's the big idea. So turn the metronome on before you start practicing. So that's number one. Number two is make sure you use all the tempos. A metronome can go, let's see, I wonder what the bottom, I'm using an app called Time Guru, looks like that. I'll talk more about it in a little bit later in this tip. It goes down to 5 beats per minute. That's pretty slow, and the top tempo it has is 300, which is really fast. It sounds like this. And if you want to know what 5 sounds like, it sounds like this. So, you know, there's maybe not going to be a lot of real music in your life that's at 5 beats per minute or 300 beats per minute. But my point is that in between there's a lot of range. So make sure that you use all of that range. The metronome, I find that people tend to gravitate towards the same few tempos. What do they get a comfort zone. Yeah, oh, I can play my scales at this tempo. And then they just hang out there for a long time, maybe for years. And of course, you want to be comfortable at a variety of tempos. So use that little slider or wheel or whatever it looks like on your app, or if you have a real, you know, like a chord digital metronome or something, you know, whatever it is that adjusts the tempo, make sure that you get a good amount of use out of those buttons. So that's number two. Number three is similar, but instead of adjusting the metronome, you're going to adjust yourself. So number three is make sure that you play all sorts of different subdivisions along with the metronome. So I'm going to get to like, go back to 92, because that's a pretty good little tempo. And I'm going to slow it down because that'll give me the chance to play some faster things. So this is 67. I just landed there. So one thing you want to be able to do is just play at that tempo. So I'm going to just play a G major scale in quarter notes. You could do that for a while, and then start to think about other subdivisions, like, of course, eighth notes. Yeah, and if it's not perfect, that's okay. Just keep working on it. Maybe slow down a little bit. And then there's other things. There's quarter note triplets, like, there's eighth note triplets. Kinds of subdivisions. There's fives and sevens, if you can hear that stuff and feel that stuff. And I'm just, for demonstration purposes here, I've just been doing a very short bit at each subdivision. But what you'd really want to do is hang out there for, you know, 4 or 5 minutes until you're really just comfortable in that subdivision, and then switch to another subdivision. So maybe do quarter note triplets for 4 or 5 minutes, and then, you know, even and you don't have to stay in one position. You could move around the neck and just pick a key center like G major or B minor or whatever, and just try to play, you know, keep it moving and play in whatever subdivision you'd like against that tempo so that you're really comfortable there. And once you've spent a few minutes in a variety of subdivisions, then improvise more freely so that you can move back and forth between them within phrases. So you might have a phrase that incorporates some quarter notes and some eighth notes and some quarter note triplets, and you really want to be fluid with those so that you're not boxed into just a chunk of triplets and a chunk of eighth notes, but that your phrasing can be more free. I'll see if I can do that. So this will be, I'll switch to B minor now, and I'll try to play a variety of subdivisions. I'll start with eighth notes. Quarter note triplets. Eighth notes. Quarter note triplets again. Triplets. Yeah, I fell off there, but I think I got back on. So you see the point, I hope. The reason, now number four is I really wanted to mention this specific thing about Time Guru that I find useful. There may be other apps that do this, but one of the reasons I like this is it has this random mute feature. So I'll speed it up a little bit. So this is 112. And now I'm gonna move this other slider over. This is the random mute slider. So it's at 27% now. So it means 27% of the time there's not gonna be a click and I have to be responsible for the time. 2, 3, 4. So I'm just improvising in C major now. Useful, and you can have it, you know, more muted than that if you want. Just helps you, you know, be more and more progressively responsible for the time so that eventually you don't need a lot of hand-holding from the metronome, even though you still are checking in with it occasionally. Of course, you know, you don't want to just practice scales. You could practice chords in time. You know, just practice whatever you want to work on, whatever you feel needs work, and, you know, practice things that you might actually get called to do on a gig or a recording session. The idea is really to just be prepared to play music in time, whether that's playing with other people or playing with a click track or playing with other people with a click track or, you know, whatever. Music does happen in time. It moves forward. It's got momentum. When you're playing with real people as opposed to a click track or a metronome, things can fluctuate a little bit, but I still think that practicing with a metronome can be helpful towards that goal, because it helps you to tune into some other element besides just being in your own bubble of time. Okay, and then number five, the fifth thing I wanted to mention is and this is something I got from Wayne Krantz, who you may be familiar with. I saw him talk about this in a video. I'll put the video down below so you can check it out yourself. Something he says that's really important about practicing with a metronome is to record yourself practicing with a metronome and then listen to that. And I think that's it's something I hadn't really thought of before. Before I heard Wayne talk about it, but I think it's a great, it makes total sense when we're in the moment, when we're practicing, and I think having the metronome on can cause a little more stress or anxiety, so we're a little bit anxious and stressed out, and we don't have a good sense of what we really, really, really sound like. And if you record yourself practicing with a metronome and listen back, you'll have a much better sense of how you're doing. Not just how it feels in the moment. I mean, how you feel is valid, of course. If we're talking about a recording session or a show or whatever, what matters is the performance. That has to come across one way or another. So you really want to be as aware of that as you can. How do you really sound? Are you really in time? Or do you just think you're in time? Or do you think you're not in time when you're doing it and then you listen and realize, gee, you know, my time's better than I thought. But I need to work on this or that, or, you know, you'll certainly find things that need work. Anyway, those are my five metronome related tips. So that's this week's episode for the letter M. Thank you for tuning in, and I'll be back next week to talk about something that begins with N. Here in Los Angeles for Guitar Tips, I'm Adam Levy. Stay tuned and take good care.